happy listeners, you humans who have had the bright inclination to come and listen to ThinkTech Hawaii. My name is Jeff Gere, and I have a present for you. Yeah, a TV present. Now, come up close to the screen so you can feel the warmth that's emanating, that's about to pour forth. For today, we have with us here in the studio, visiting Hawaii for about the 700th time, in order to perform in the 25th annual Talk Story Festival, which, if you're in real time, is this Friday and Saturday down at the Alawai Golf Clubhouse, the 18th and 19th, 6 to 9. It's absolutely free. Put on by the Department of Parks and Recreation. Here for the Talk Story Festival is my good friend Lynn Ford from Ohio. Let's have a hand for her right now.
Oh, thank you so much.
This is sort of like we're in our living room, but actually it's in the studio and you get to look in. Lynn is famous. I mean, she's like one of the preeminent. She's like a constellation in the storytelling firmament of America. She is the one they call when they want to get spooky. She likes to freak people out. And you're lucky enough to be here watching through your TV tube, and she is going to take us to places. Well, I'm glad you're with me because gonna get a little freaky.
You think so? You think
I know so?
Well, we'll start off a little silly, if that's okay.
Let's have it for Lynn Ford, hands on the TV.
thank you so much. Want to tell you a story about a little old woman. And she had picked up her broom and started to sweep her floor. She was sweeping and sweeping, and she was getting tired, so she started to sing a little bit, make the time pass more quickly. She sang a song that she sang all the time. Nee, 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 nee. Very annoying song. Then she heard a knock at the door, and when she opened the door, there was a man made of nothing but bone. It was Death, and he held his hand out to her, and he said, "Old woman, I have come for you. It's time for you to go." That old woman looked at Death, and she said, "Not yet. I haven't finished sweeping this floor. Now you can come on in and help me sweep the floor, make it go quickly." And Death said, "I do not sweep." "Well, if you want me to go anywhere, you better help me with this floor." And Death didn't know what else to do. And so she handed him a broom, and he walked in and he started to sweep the floor right along with that old woman. And the time was going so slowly, she started to sing again. Nee, 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 nee. And she told Death, "If you sing with me, the work will be much more fun. So sing." Death said, "Old woman,
click.
I do not sing." "Well, you're gonna sing right now, 'cause I told you, sing." And Death didn't know what else to do. No one had talked to him like this before. And so he started to sing. "Never mind, honey, don't sing, that's all right. We'll just sweep." So they swept the floor, and when the work was done, the brooms were set beside the door. And Death said, "Old woman, it is time for you to go." "Not yet. Haven't finished with my cooking yet. Come on in the kitchen and help me with that." Death said, "Old woman, I do not cook." She said, "Well, you're going to help me cook today, or I'm not going anywhere, okay?" And Death walked into the kitchen with that old woman, and he started to help her, cutting up the vegetables and the fruit, putting things on the table, stirring up the stew, putting out the tablecloths. He carried things, tableware, and plates and bowls and cups. And when the tables were set and the food was there, Death held out his hand again. "Old woman, it is time for you to..." "Not yet. Haven't got on my party clothes yet. You stand at the door and greet my guests when they come to the door." Death said, "Greet your guests? Yes, I have to get dressed in my party clothes. I want you to stand at the door and be polite. When someone knocks, you open the door. You say hello and welcome, and you invite them in. Stand at the door." Well, Death walked over to the door, and the old woman went to dress in her party dress. And soon there was a knock at the door. and death opened it. There were two young people standing there, a young woman and a young man, and death said, "Welcome. Do come in." Well, the young woman looked at that young man. She said, "Do you see what I see standing at the door?" Young man said, "I do." "You think we should go on in the house?" Young man said, "Well, it is Grandma's house. And yes, I guess it might be all right. It does look like he's smiling." "Smiling," said the young man, "how can you tell?" But they walked on in the house. And soon there were others who came to the door, and each time death opened it and greeted them and welcomed them in. And soon the house was filled with people, and they were dancing and singing and eating and laughing. And that old woman walked out of her room in her party dress. She was wearing her dancing shoes. And as she danced with folks from her family and her friends, a little boy walked over to Death, who was standing in the corner. The little boy had a piece of cake on a plate. He held it out to Death and said, "Mr. Bony Man, you too skinny. Here, eat this." Death said, "Go away, boy, I do not eat." "Eat this. Get away from me, child. I have no need for food. Eat this. Eat it. Eat it. Eat it." Well, that old woman walked over and said, "Look what you did. You made my great-grandbaby cry. Shame on you. If he wants you to eat something, you eat it. You understand?" And so Death, a bit afraid of that old woman, opened up his jaws, and the little boy shoved that piece of cake into his mouth. It bounced down his neck bones, right through his rib cage, down through the pelvic bones, and fell in a lump at his feet. Well, when the little boy saw that, he grinned, got another piece of cake, brought it over and said, "Here, eat this." And Death opened up his jaws, and down went that cake and broke up into crumbs on the floor. And soon children were rushing over and throwing things in Death's mouth, and there was a pile of food sitting at his feet. Then that first little boy walked over with a big glass of punch and said, "Here, drink it." And Death opened up his jaws, and the juice was poured down his bones and settled in a puddle at his feet. And soon his feet were sticking to the floor. His bones were sticky from top to bottom. He tried to move, and his feet stuck to the floor. He tried to pull his feet away, and his knee bones clicked together. And soon there was a rhythm as he tried to walk. And the children started to dance to the rhythm of Death's knee bones and feet. And soon others saw that, and they began to dance, and the band began to play a different tune to the rhythm of Death's bones and sticky feet. And then that old woman walked up to Death, and she took his hand, and he took her arm, and they began to dance around and around and around in that room. And when everyone was tired, the dancing stopped, and all the guests went home. And soon there were only two in that room, the old woman and Death. She said to him, "Well, I want to thank you. This was my 100th birthday. It was going to be a special one, and I didn't want to miss it, but now I guess I'm ready to go." And she held out her hand to Death, who said, "Not yet. Old woman, this was too much fun. We have to do this again. I'll be back next year." And Death walked away and returned for her next birthday, and the next, and the next. And when she was 103 years old and truly felt it was time to go, Death held out his hand, and she took it without any fear, because you see, she and her children and her grandchildren and the whole community had no fear of death. They had all danced with death. And that's the end of that story. Thank you, thank you.
Well, you know, I can't quite get enough. And since time goes by quickly when you're having fun and doing TV, and because we're experimenting with the technology of putting a picture behind your face, Lynn, we looked these up at our house just last night and thought, that looked good for this story, that looked good for this story. And Ian in the back of the studio behind the camera that you're looking at us in, he's just kind of freelancing the images. And as I was looking at that, Lynn, I was thinking, images are good, but sometimes it's good not to have an image. And so I'm saying that out loud because you at the TV can watch what Ian, in his communion with the story, feels when he puts the image in and takes it out. Let's see what happens with the next story. What's this one called?
Be careful what you wish for.
That was my wish, and I'm going to be careful and see what Ian has to do with it. Let's have another hand for Lynn Ford, all the way from Ohio, to tell you spooky stories.
Thank you. This one's kind of a companion to the other one, and it's kind of short.
Flip that image now, Ian. There you go.
Are we ready? And it's another elder, because that's what I intend to be when I grow up, an elder. And it's a story that actually starts in sadness. You see, there was an older gentleman. In some stories, he's called John. In others, he is Simon. But he was enslaved and eventually gained his freedom in those stories of the United States and the Civil War and the Underground Railroad. And John had found a place to live, but he hadn't found any family there. When he decided he was going to stay there, he was all alone. Still, he worked as hard as he could in his little garden, and he tended his little house, and he would go and gather firewood, and he would sit outside on the porch and watch the sun go down, get up early in the morning, watch the sun come up. This was his day. He was an elder by the time he was free, and he got even older, because that's what happens. And one day he went out to get that firewood, and his arms were aching. You see, the wagon was broken, and he had to carry the firewood back to the cabin all by himself. And as he took those steps, his legs began to tremble and shake. The knees ached, the ankles burned, his hands grew sore, his wrists were hurting, his arms were tired, and the perspiration was beading up on his forehead. But he kept on walking with that firewood. And he thought about it. He was taking the firewood back to a house where no one else lived except him. He was taking the firewood back there to light a fire for no one but himself. He was all alone, and he was sore and tired and so old, he thought it was time to go. And so he threw the firewood down on the ground, dropped down to his knees, and called out, "Death, oh death, please come. I wish you would come right now." And up jumped Death. And Death looked at that old man, and that old man looked at Death. And Death said, "Man, you called me. Did you call me because you're ready to go with me?" And John said, "No. That's not why I called you. I was calling you to see if you'd help me with this firewood here, but I'm starting to feel a little bit better, not quite so tired, so I think I'll just pick it all up and carry it on home myself. Bye." And John jumped up, and he grabbed all that firewood, and he ran home faster than he had run when he was a young man. And he thought about it. Sometimes you need to be careful what you're wishing for. Now, in my family, that was stated as being careful what you wished for and being careful what you prayed for. But whichever way you looked at it, be careful about what falls out your mouth, because you never know who might be listening. Could be Death.
Oh, what fun.
Oh, thank you.
You know, I feel like I just had a full meal, but I'm not done yet. I want a dessert and a couple other little courses.
All right.
But let's have a little break here and go to ThinkTech cutaways and colorful personalities associated with the television station. Take it away, Ian.
I'm Nicole Horry for ThinkTech. For nearly half a century, The Hawaii Foreign Trade Zone No. 9 has brought the benefits of the Foreign Trade Zone program to Hawaii businesses and entrepreneurs. DBET, the Department of Business, Economic Development, and Tourism, operates Hawaii's Foreign Trade Zone program to encourage international business and economic development. The Foreign Trade Zone's mission is to increase the amount of international trading activity in Hawaii, thereby providing employment opportunities for the residents of our island state. For more information, see ftz9.org. I'm Nicole Hori. Mahalo. Aloha. I'm Nicole Hori for ThinkTech.
Another. They didn't really know one another, but they thought it would last forever. And the young man made up a song for his new bride. Who's gonna walk with me through this long, lovely life? It's true, my darling, it's you. And they made their way to the cabin that he had built for her, high up in the hills, deep in the forest. They thought their privacy would be important to them. And when you're young like that, maybe it is. But when you get older and you're scared everybody away because you're so mean, so ornery, so cruel, and you don't even like one another, and you're all that you got, could be a really bad situation. One evening, that old man forgot to get the firewood. He didn't have as much sense as John. He was walking along with the lantern in his hands, and his wife was walking along behind him. She had the axe in the wagon that she was pulling along as she fussed at him. If you'd remember the firewood, we wouldn't be out here. It's going to be dark and it's going to get cool. And we're out here walking along. If we get lost out here, we only got the lantern to see. What is wrong with you, old man? And he sucked on the only tooth he had left in his head. And he sang as she walked behind him. Who's going to walk with me through this long, lonely life? It's you, old woman, it's you. And she said, shut up before I knock out your last tooth. Well, he kept on walking through the woods, him walking in front of her, and she just kept on fussing, and he just kept on singing, and finally her nerves couldn't stand it anymore. We wouldn't be out here getting the firewood if you'd remembered to get it today. Who's gonna walk with me? Shut up, you old fool, stop singing that song. Through this long, lonely life. Be quiet, I'm sick of that song. It's you, old woman. Well, before he could finish the song, she picked up that axe. She took a step back. She swung that thing and whoosh, cut that old man's head clean off. The body dropped to the ground on its knees and fell forward, and that head dropped and rolled until it settled in front of her feet. His eyes were wide open. His mouth was hanging open. It was rocking back and forth, that old head. With his eyes looking up at her, he looked a bit surprised. She looked down at him. She said, look what you made me do now. Shame on you. And then she looked at the body. It was too heavy to drag anywhere. She figured if she just left it there, Mother Nature would take care of it. But it seemed kind of wrong to leave his head rolling around on the path. So she grabbed it by the last hairs that he had on it, and she threw it in that wagon. Put the axe in the wagon, picked up the lantern. No firewood tonight. She walked on home, and the sun was going down. And she looked at what was in that wagon. And she set the axe down, and she picked up the head, and she set it on the front porch step, kind of like a jack-o'-lantern. She sat down in the rocking chair on the front porch, watching the last rays of the sun coming up over the trees. And she looked at that head and said, "See what you made me do. I was sick of you anyway, but I didn't expect to do that." She just kept on rocking there, thinking no firewood, no light for the evening, when she felt a breeze coming from the woods and touching her cheek. And she heard a whisper coming out of the woods in that breeze. "Who's gonna walk with me through this long, lonely life? It's you, old woman. It's you." Well, she looked down at that head. "Did you say something?" But he was still looking kind of astonished, straight out toward the woods. And that breeze got a little harder, and the voice in the wind came a little closer. "Who's gonna walk with me through this long, lonely life? How are you singing? I don't even see your mouth moving. Shut up." And the breeze blew a little harder, and she noticed as the full moon began to rise that there was something coming out of the woods toward her, something walking along, something that didn't have a head. And the voice seemed to be coming from that direction, not from the head that was sitting on the front porch like a jack-o'-lantern. It was coming in the breeze as that thing walked closer, holding out its hands and singing, "Who's gonna walk with me through this long, lonely life? Be quiet, be quiet. You're dead. You shouldn't be singing. Shut up." She got up and she looked at that thing. It was coming closer, hands out, walking right toward her. "It's you, old woman." Shut up," she said. And she looked for the axe, but even in the moonlight, she couldn't find it on the ground. She took a few steps toward that thing. She didn't know what she'd do to it. But she said, "Stop singing that song. Stop singing that song." One hand reached out, grabbed the side of her neck. The other reached out and grabbed her shoulder. There was a twist and a snap. And then everything was silent in the woods. Now they say nobody went to check on those two old folks, because they were mean and ornery and cruel. And now they say that if you go into the woods on a full moon night, you'll see what's left of an old cabin. And you might see coming from the ruins a couple, an old man who walks along toward the woods, holding out his head like a lantern, and the eyes are glowing, showing them the way to go and find the firewood. Walking beside him is that old woman. She's holding on to his arm the way she did when she was a young bride. She has to, you see, because although her feet are moving in one direction, her head is turned around, looking in the direction from which they have come. But now they have no choice. They walk arm in arm. Finally and forever, that old couple walks together.
Well, well, well. So my prayer to all you visitors, all you guests, all you viewing public out there, is that you're nice enough to your beloved that once you behead each other, people come around in the house and check on you. Just a little thought from ThinkTech Hawaii to you viewing at home. Lynn, that was really gruesome.
Thank you. Right. That was the plan.
Now, you've told me before that if someone like cuts you off in traffic or is rude at the bank, you go home and make up a story to take your revenge out on them.
That's right. I usually put them in a spooky story and kill them off in some way. Yeah, that's right.
Well, I'll hope that you'll enjoy this video experience and not put me in one of your stories.
No. You're a friend. It's okay.
I gotta work harder at it. Yeah.
Okay. It's okay.
I've got some friends to suggest, actually, you could do a few stories with.
Oh, okay.
Well, because life is fleeting and you've got so many stories, and I know you've prepared a few of them, and I know Ian's ready to push those buttons and turn the background into something. And I like that black behind you. I don't know if you saw it, but at one point he went black. It was really cool.
Oh, good,
looked really nice. You were like stark. Yeah. And Ian could put them in and out. We're playing with that technology, friends. Look, you've got a little red swirl around you, too. Okay, so now. What do you got up your sleeve now, man?
Well, it's a twisted kind of a folk tale. And I think once you start hearing it, you're going to understand who's in it. I like to twist scary folk tales. They're already a little creepy. I like to make them worse.
Okay. Here she is. Lynn Ford from Ohio.
Thank you.
Take it away.
All right. You could begin this story with the words, once upon a time, but those don't always lead to happily ever after. This is a story that's told in the first person. For I sold my soul. It changed my life and my name. And upon that hangs the tale. You see, I was sick of living in the country, sick and tired of working the farm that had been left by my mother and my father. I was sick and tired of taking care of my younger brothers. I was so tired of it all, I wanted to do something else, have some kind of adventure. But there was no one that would help me with that, you see. Those of higher estate looked down upon me, and I didn't have an education, didn't have many choices, and so I went to the healers, the herb women, the wise women, and chose the one who just didn't seem to be quite as good in heart and spirit as the others. And she sent me to the crossroads at midnight. I stood at the crossroads, and sure enough, at midnight, I saw a shadow cast upon the ground, and it turned into a jester. He was carrying a mandolin, and as he played it, the bells on his hat and the tips of his shoes began to jingle. But I knew who he was, and I couldn't help myself. I said, "A jester? You appear as a jester? Why not a king?" He laughed, and I smelled fire, brimstone and sulfur coming from his throat, and he said, "My life is a joke. What do you want, mortal?" And I said, "I want a change. I want a different life. I don't want to live in the country anymore. I want excitement. I want an adventure. I want to live for 100 years and have everything I want or need. And I want you to curse my mother's sons. Make them small and ugly, the way they made my life. That's what I want." He grinned and he said, "Done. But do you know the price for this?" And that made my turn to laugh begin. "Yes, I know what I'm supposed to give you. And if there is such a thing as a soul, I don't have any need for it. Take it. Just give me what I want." "Done and done," he said. And I don't remember the next moment. All I remember is waking up next to a stream, ravenously hungry and so tired. And I looked down into the water. The silvery fish swimming there made me even hungrier. And I reached in with one hand and managed to grab a fish and squeeze it to death and eat it raw. And as I ate, I saw my reflection in the water and I screamed. And all the rest of the day I cried. Even when I ran away from a she-wolf who was trying to protect her pups from me and my hunger, and I discovered that these two hands could tear a wolf apart, and the blood and the flesh were sweet and good. And after a while, I was still crying, but I was walking along just touching things, and my fingers turned a leaf to gold. I touched a blueberry, and it became a pearl. I scooped up some water at that stream, and it turned into wine. Those same hands that could tear a wolf apart could give me anything I wanted. I finally found a cave and went inside to hide. I didn't want anybody to see me. At the back of the cave, there was a tunnel. And when I went into that tunnel, I found a cavern filled with coal. But I was so angry. I was so sorrowful. I snatched up a piece of coal and I squeezed it, and it became a diamond. Well, I was back at the crossroads that night, and at midnight, I saw just a bit of flame flickering and dancing, and then he appeared. He was still dressed like the jester and still carrying that mandolin, and I told him, "You have cheated me. You tricked me. You didn't give me what I wanted." But he said, "Ah, is your life an adventure now? Is it not exciting? And can you not get anything you want or make it yourself? And you, like your brothers, will live for 100 years. And like your brothers, you are rumpled and stilted in growth and withered of skin. For you too are your mother's son. Did you forget that?" Rumpled, stilted in growth, withered of skin. I think the name for you is in that. Well, I cried and begged and pleaded for my soul to be returned, and he told me if I brought him one that was pure and clean and new, he would give back my own, and I agreed to that. It took me almost 100 years to realize what he wanted. I brought young people and old, people who seemed sweet and seemed innocent, but each one had committed some misdemeanor, some small wickedness, some type of crime, and I knew that what he wanted was pure and clean and new because the life had not yet been lived. And so I found a young woman who had a dilemma. Her father, in some drunken state, had told the king that his daughter could spin straw into gold. And she had been told if she did not do that by sunrise, she would die. Took no time at all to find a crack to creep up the stairs to a chamber where she sat in a dress that the maid servants had given her, wearing a diamond ring and a pearl necklace. And I made a deal with her the way a deal had been made with me. And she gave me the diamond ring. I touched the straw, it turned to gold. But the next day she was taken to a room with more straw, for that king was greedy. And she gave me her pearl necklace, and I gave her more gold. But when there was no jewelry to give me, I told her I wanted her firstborn child. And she agreed to that. She was an innocent, ignorant, unmarried, and she had no idea that when enough gold had been made, the king would want her body. The innocence of some, what prices they pay. She became the queen, and she bore a son. And by that time, the king was not interested anymore. He went on to other women and other things. And it took no time at all for me to just walk into her bedchamber and demand my price. She begged and pleaded and cried as I had. And I felt sorry for it, just a little. I gave her 3 chances and 3 wishes in each chance. 9 times she could try to guess my name. And the first guesses were country names, and the second guesses, well, everyone who loved her, the servants, the cooks, the guards, tried to give her some kind of odd name. And that evening I lit a big fire. I threw a party for myself, for I knew I would get back my soul. I ate a bear. I tore him open and devoured his innards, and I decided that what was left of him would become a coat and a pie. And I danced around that fire and sang about my name, sang about my freedom, and the next day, well, she knew the song. She knew the words. Rumpled, stilted in growth, and withered of skin, she said my name. And I screamed. For all that was lost, I tore at my face. I jumped up and down. I stomped upon the earth until my foot went right into the ground. And then with these hands, these strong hands that could change things, I grabbed the other leg and I tore myself in two. Please note that such temper tantrums do absolutely no good. For I was drawn into the earth, and here now I serve my master, who no longer dresses as a jester. And sometimes I see the other half of myself hopping along on some errand. We try to embrace and put ourselves together, but we can't. We can't change that. And he plays his mandolin and laughs and taps his hoof to keep the beat. While that young woman, well, she left the palace. She took her son and went into the deep, dark woods, where she found a little house, the home of my brothers, and she cooked and cleaned for all seven of them. They took good care of her, and then they would go into their mines, a place where they had found coal that had been squeezed into diamonds. And she and her son became the queen mother and the king when that old, mean king died. She moved into the palace, and they did live happily ever after. But time and storytellers amended that tale. It has become a tale of one with lips as red as blood, skin as white as snow, hair black like coal. The story began with me, but that story, as my story, are called by another name. Thank you.
We'll be back sometime. Let's take a break. I'm about to fall apart.
I'm Bill Spencer, president of the Hawaii Venture Capital Association. We do monthly luncheon programs with ThinkTech about things that matter to Hawaii entrepreneurs, investors, and business service providers. So join us on the fourth Thursday of every month at the Plaza Club. For information about upcoming events or to join our mailing list, visit hvca.org. See you there.
We are here with Lynn Ford.
Are you okay?
I don't know, Lynn.
Those are pretty heavy stories.
And I'm not such a big guy after all.
So why don't we have one that's a little funnier then?
Do you have a funny kind of spooky story for a Halloween boy?
Sure.
Come on, kids. Get it back together. We can have another story from Lynn Ford. She's going to tell us it's not so heavy. Cool.
Thank you. Now, this is a story about somebody that you may know. They call him Jack. But in some stories, he was called Soldier Jack. And when Jack came home from the war, some say the Revolutionary War, some say the Civil War, doesn't matter, he was not the same child. His mother was always worried because he would do stupid things like climb up on the roof to see the sun rise, stand at the edge of the roof to watch the sun set, reach into the coals to get the potatoes that he was roasting for himself with his bare hands. And his mother said, "Child, you don't have any sense. Aren't you afraid?" He said, "Mama, I've been through a war. I don't have any more fears." And she said, "You better find some, because common sense is a part of having fears." And he didn't seem to have any common sense. She finally got so tired of it all, so worried about her son, that she sent him out the door with a bite to eat. She told him, "You go and you find a fear. Don't come back without one." And he thought, "Find a fear? I have no idea how to do that." So it took him a long time. He just kept on walking, until he saw a house that was kind of ramshackle, run down, the chimney hanging down to one side of the roof, and the windows broken, the door open and creaking on its hinges, and there was a man standing there, looking at the house and shaking his head. Jack thought, "Well, maybe that's a fear. It's an ugly house. Maybe it's a fearful one, too." And he went to the man and said, "Why are you standing here looking at the house?" And the man said, "I wanted to fix it up for my daughter. But nobody will stay in it long enough to do any fixing, and I'm too afraid to be in there myself because it's haunted. It was the kinfolk's property, and I want to keep it in the family, but I can't give it to my daughter like this. And Jack said, oh, really? There's something fearful in that house? Well, I'm supposed to find my fear, so why don't you let me stay here? And if I see something that's a fear, I'll scare it out, and your daughter can move in when the house is fixed. And the man said, well, you're so brave, young man. He said, I'm Soldier Jack. Well, why don't you stay here? And if you can get rid of whatever's fearful in this house, not only will I ask you to help fix it up for my daughter, maybe I'll introduce you to her and you can do a little courting, and I'll give you a little money besides. And Jack thought, well, that sounds good. And he went on in there, and the man brought some firewood to the door, wouldn't go in. And Jack lit a fire in the fireplace, even though the chimney was crooked. And he pulled out the bits that his mother had given him to eat, some bread and some cheese, and he sat down in front of that fire, and pretty soon he heard something falling down the chimney, and it landed, boom, right in the fireplace. It was a pair of feet. He pulled them out and said, what you doing falling down into the fire? What's wrong with you? Look, your toenails are singed. And he threw the feet to one side and kept on eating. Then a pair of legs fell down, boom, boom. And he pulled him out. Look at you. Your knee bones are burning. What's wrong with you? And he threw him down. And then there were arms and a body all falling down that chimney. And he just threw him to one side. And then he heard a voice coming down the chimney. Oh, I'm falling. And Jack said, well, everything else fell. You might as well fall too. Come on down. And boom, big old head fell into the fireplace. The hair was ablaze, and Jack pulled it out and bashed that head until the hair wasn't burning, and then he set it down and said, well, I guess you go with the rest of the body there. Shame that you couldn't all fall down in one piece. Pull yourself together, and I'll give you something to eat. And the whole thing pulled itself together, but whoosh, it disappeared. Well, I wonder if I was supposed to be afraid of that, Jack said. Maybe that was a fear. And then he heard something at the top of the stairs, and when he walked over that way, he saw a skeleton trying to make its way down the stairs toward him. Bony fingers reaching out toward him, hands coming toward him. Well, he reached out and shook one of those bony hands. Hi, how you doing? You're awful skinny. Would you like to get something to eat? And the head just shook. Oh, don't talk very much, do you? Well, you know, I'm getting bored here. I'm supposed to find a fear. Maybe we could play a game while I'm waiting to find one. There's a game that I learned when I was with the rest of the soldiers. We used to put candlesticks up and throw things at them, knock everything down. They call it bowling. We could do that. It's fun, but we don't have any candlesticks. I know. And he ripped off the legs and took them apart and set them up like candlesticks and ripped off the arms and set those up, took a couple ribs, and pretty soon he had the pins. If we only had a ball, your skull will do. And he ripped off the skull, rolled it toward the pins, knocked them all down. Now it's your turn. Oh, I guess you can't play. You're in pieces and parts all over the floor. Sorry. Well, the bones disappeared. And when Jack turned to go back to the fireplace, there was a hand glowing, burning right in front of his face. And the fingers curled and made sure that he knew to follow. And he followed the hand. Are you a fearful thing? I thought maybe those bones were supposed to be a fearful thing. But you're kind of different. I'll see where you're going. And the hand went right through a door. Jack said, I can't walk through a door. You better open it up. And the door opened up, and he went down some stairs following that glowing, burning hand, which pointed at a pile that looked like trash. But when Jack came closer, he saw it was bags, and in one were bits of silver, and another pieces of gold, and another silver tableware, and another crystal goblets, a treasure, jewels, dollar bills. He hoped they were still good after the war, and he looked at that hand, and it turned into a man who said, I've been waiting for someone to come so I could tell my story. I hid my treasure from those who came to take it, and they took our lives instead. Oh, how I wished I had realized that my family's lives and my own were so much more important than all of this. But now that I have told someone of my guilt, I can go in peace, and you can have the treasure and this house. And Jack said, well, thank you so much. Whoosh, that man disappeared, and Jack called out, could you send the hand back? I can't see where I'm going in the dark. But he had to make his way through the darkness without that glowing hand. And when the man came with his daughter the next day, there was Jack sitting on the front porch with big bags of treasure. And Jack said, I didn't see anything fearful in the house, but I found a treasure. And the ghost told me that I could have the house, but that's yours. Can I just keep some of this? And the man said, you can have it all. Thank you so much. You're so brave. This is my daughter. Maybe you could do a little courting. And the young woman looked at Jack. He was cute. She walked over to him and she gave him a little kiss on the cheek. And suddenly Jack felt goosebumps running up and down his body. And he began to tremble and shake. Oh, do some courting. I think I found a fear. I don't want to get married. And he grabbed some of those bags and he ran back home to his mom. And she said, well, Jack, did you find a fear? He said, yes, ma'am, I did. And I found a treasure, too. And his mother was so happy. They could fix up the farm. They could plant more crops. And after a while, Jack did do some courting. He wasn't afraid of getting married anymore. But when he and his good wife had children, they taught him there's nothing wrong with the common sense that comes from finding your fear.
Yeah.
Thank you. thank you.
Oh, boy.
Thanks, Lynn.
You're welcome.
That was a real fun little spooky session we had just now. Didn't we have that?
Yeah, I think it was fun. Thank
you. Well, everybody that saw it, you could all say yay. Say it. Ready? Yeah, that was a lot of fun. Lynn Ford, all the way from Ohio. Thank you, Lynn, for coming and telling stories on ThinkTech Hawaii.
Oh, thank you for having me here, Mr. Jeff.
Yay, everybody! We'll have more stories later. Bye.